Good.
One thing about it, walking through the house like I'm going to see you. And by the way, if anybody's in the grocery room this morning, we can have a session in the office later on. But before you leave worship this morning, I anticipate all of you to be in a really good mood. So, you know, I had a district president friend of mine, President Gina, and his Bible passage, "This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it." And what a great way to think about life, you know? And that's really the way it is. Unfortunately, I'm not smart enough to choose that one. So, anyway, today, if you look in your worship folder, that item has been hymns. And more importantly, I learned a sermon. Now, you can really hurry worship along a lot if you all just sit there quietly. So I'm really here to answer any questions, topics, thoughts, Bible passages, relationship with modern day affairs, whatever is on your mind, please feel free to ask that during the sermon time. But right now, I need to open here.
I heard 162
like four times. I mean, what is it? When I come, I will be born two and five. How about people say, how many verses do we have? I don't know how many verses. Four?
Five.
We'll do one, two, and five.
What song?
The second
cross. 162 and all God's people sing.
Four is, I mean, what are you singing? Two. But one, two, and five. Lift Isaac's cross. One, two, and five. I don't know.
162
and all God's people sing. Yeah, I didn't hear the Bible was singing it so well. Wow, this is a great way to start with you. Get you fired up. And you're competitive around life. Kurt, you probably were the first one to have your hand up because you didn't shout loud enough.
I don't think I'm in school.
Did you have a case watch it?
Raise your hand.
Sir, 1, 2, and 5. Yeah, those are 3 verses of it.
Thank you.
All right, now that you've raised your voices, I ask you to raise your bodies and open your hearts. As we gather together in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
My friends, we say we have no sin, we can see by ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, will forgive our sins, and let us from our righteousness.
Oh, let us then confess our sins to God our Father.
Oh, Lord, God, we confess that we are having existed in one family. We have sinned against you in thoughts, word, and deed, by what we have done with it, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your presence and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and give us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, His mercy has given His Son to die for us, and for His sake forgives us all our sins. As an ordained servant of Christ, and by His authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Before the house where I was having been sent to me from Caesarea. Then the Spirit told me to go with them, doubting nothing. Moreover, these six brethren accompanied me, and we entered the man's house. And he told us how he had seen an angel standing in his house, and said to them, "Send the men to Joppa, and call for Simon, his surname is Peter, who will tell you words by which you and all your household will be saved." And as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell upon them, as upon us at the beginning. Then I remembered the word of the Lord, how he said, "John will be baptizing with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit." If therefore God gave them the same gift as he gave us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could withstand God? When they heard these things, they became silent. And they glorified God, saying, "Then God has also granted to the Gentiles repentance to life." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please rise for the Alleluia. And they show us our sin as God has intended them to do. Today in our gospel lesson, Christ gives us a new and eleventh commandment, one we should strive to live by. Holy Gospel for this morning is written in the 13th chapter of the Gospel according to St. John, beginning at the 31st verse.
Glory to you, Lord.
So when they had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man is glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and glorify him in me. Little children, I shall be with you a little while longer. You will seek me. And as I said to the Jews, where I am going, you cannot come. So now I say to you, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." This is the Gospel of Jesus.
Praise be to God.
Please, be seated. Now, let me ask you one sermon this time, whether it's by action or shout, or that sermon hymn that we all are going to say. It's May 22, I heard. The first day. May
22.
Oh, hallelujah, let praises ring. May 22 in the hymn. Now let's say verse 1 and 2. The first two verses of 8:22.
Thank you.
home and get my head to me. Grace be unto you from God our Father, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and just by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. From time to time, I take that opportunity to turn the worship service over to you because there are many things that pastors teach, preach, and sometimes you miss the mark just a little. And that's why I chose to go here and give you the opportunity to ask those things that are in your heart. So at this time I ask anyone who would like to be, please, ask for a fellow to work for our insight and everything.
What is wokeism? We had a Bible study on it, and what's the simple explanation of what it is?
The question is, what is wokeism? In my office, I do have extra copies of that Bible study, if anybody would like, and you can work through it yourself. There's an answer key in the back of on the back of the book, these lessons. You can work through it and answer the question statements that are there on your own if you so desire. When Adam and Eve fell into sin, see, if I was going to expect someone else to do it, when Adam and Eve fell into sin, the very first thing that happened to them is they became completely self-absorbed. They became, in their own eyes, God. Because they left the very relationship that they had with God. They left the purity, the holiness, the blamelessness that was a part of everything that they were, body and soul. And walked away. And when they broke the relationship with God, they became totally self-centered. And becoming self-centered means that you have all the answers within yourself. And humanity has all the answers for things of life and death and eternity and the like. For history, various individuals have come up and arisen over history that really agitated, and forced that very idea. Earlier, in fact, immediately, almost after Adam and Eve were driven from the garden, they had two sons, Cain and Abel. And Cain and Abel brought a sacrifice to God, and God accepted Cain's sacrifice. He did not accept Abel's sacrifice. Reverse, he accepted Abel's and not Cain's. Because that's a king's wrong. Because he didn't bring it from a pure, contrite, loving heart. And then he got jealous. He got so jealous, he got so mad, he rose up and killed first two siblings, first two children on earth. One killed the other. Because he didn't like the other. All times continues true. We have all of the monarchies throughout history. And these are all just divided and broken down and subdivided until we end up in the early 20th century, late 19th century, early 20th century, the man named Karl Marx. Karl Marx is 100% a humanist. And the humanism said God, the original God, that man is king, man is Lord, and that we should be the ultimate answer to all things. And then this gets developed until it becomes part of the education system, part of the mindset of society, and anything that is not humanistic, is not man-centered, is trash. In fact, hated. And you get to the point where it actually dominates the very idea of society itself. And when that happens, you end up with absolute suppression of the people. Now, we've heard that process, but we're most familiar with it with the form of government that Marx and his followers developed called communism. Communism is based on 100% humanity. It's based on the human idea that man is God and Lord, and quite frankly, that government is the root of all things. And government is therefore root controlled by man. And if you disobey the government, then you disobey all authority, you disobey all things, and all things that are against the government must be destroyed. Now, there are people in this world yet who still believe in Christ, who still believe in God, who still believe in a power outside of yourself. There is a great divide. Humanism says all power is within you. All forms of faith say power is outside of you and it comes to you. And if you are not part of the human psyche, which by the way dominates the world societies, then you are an enemy. And you must be either betrayed or eliminated. And woke means that you wake up to the truth of humanism. And as Christians, we can never wake up to that truth because we're children of Christ. And so therefore, if you're not awake, you're the enemy. And the demonstrations you see even today against the Supreme Court and other the very series of society is all that same philosophy. There are very few places in the world where freedom to believe what you want still exists. Now we think God, that America is one of them. You can believe anything you want. And in order to force you to believe what they tell you to believe, that is, I mean, they can do it uncannily. And if somebody walked up and stuck a 45 up your nose, you might tell them anything you want to hear. You know? But that doesn't mean to change your heart. As we cannot force someone to be a Christian, that's been experimented with in history, and it doesn't work. God brings us to the faith, and God teaches us in the faith. And the answer we have against all of those kinds of philosophies, all of those kinds of societies, literally is right there. God sent His Son, who died for our separation from God, and raised Himself from the dead to bring that separation back to unity. And it wasn't just objective, it becomes subjective or personal. To you, when that message is spoken to your ears, to your head, to your heart, to your soul, for God says, I forgive you, I bring you into the faith, I consider you one of mine. I know in God and Lord. And you have an eternity. You have an eternity. So, whenever you hear this kind of work that's on, that kind of stuff, it comes out of many different images and philosophies. It's all the same thing. There's nothing different in it. It just so happened that we've been influenced in America a lot by Marxism. Therefore, with that, you end up with the philosophy that they develop out of that. Great question, because that affects us every day, all the time of our lives. Very good. Somebody else have a question, thought, or desire, Bible passage? You should come up with all the good ways we're being influenced by TV. You know, we can see all of the mail and how, look at all the commercials, how they destroy the family, you know, the family's unit the way it should be. I've been asked to build on that a little bit and how that through advertising, entertainment, and just purchases every facet of society, education. We thank God we did it in this part of the world. Because all you have to do is go down to the St. Paul, and I guarantee your children would be subjected to things that would just make your hair stand on end. If you have to go to New York, LA, or someplace like you, you get the right clothes. And we are influenced by this because who professes to be the God of this world? Who professes to be the God of this world? We all know Satan. Satan is the one who brings all lies and treachery and death. But Satan brought to this world absolutely everything you can think of contrary to God. I don't care what it is. If it's the opposite of God, it's a gift of Satan. And therefore, he just offers it. Satan doesn't care about anything except this one thing, that you do not believe in Jesus Christ as your God and Savior for all eternity. He doesn't care if you're a communist, he doesn't care if you're a humanist, he doesn't care if you believe in worship, the sun, moon, stars, ancestors, as long as you do not believe in Christ. And he's found many ways to do it. There's been many times over history, he's tried to starve and beat people into turning from God. Then he's learned that there's a word that brings them closer to God. So what does he do? He's equally going to be calling God. He gave you so much of this world's goods that you begin to think you don't need God. But then maybe you are self-sufficient. And you will have invented all kinds of philosophies, all kinds of theories, all kinds of ideologies that want you to try to understand your behavior. And it doesn't really matter if it's a lot or a little. Because sin is like cancer. It grows inside of you, and unless you repent and kill it, it will continue to grow until you are overtaken. And if you are overtaken by it, you can say anything out of your mouth you want to, but it's what's in your heart comes. It's what's in your soul. It's what you actually believe and live what you believe. One of the probably most spoken words at any time, any day. My guess is the Lord's Prayer. Not anybody can speak words, but not everybody can pray. the Lord gives you. It's got to come from the mind of God and be put literally into your mind and into your soul. And there's his words. Would you like to go out in this song? That's what God uses. That will rock and roll song says this, they're just words. And words are all I have to steal your heart away. That's exactly what God does. God uses words. I sent my son to save you. If you hold a baptism in the words of the gospel, I do just that. And I keep you with me. I keep your soul close to me so that when you know that you've walked away, when you know you've sinned, just turn back to me and say, Lord, that's the stupid I'm sorry. And you can smile at me and say, forgive me. Restore me. Go, my child. As he said to that woman in John 8, go to the same Lord. That's really what it is. Satan doesn't affect us. The stuff the devil affects, you'll affect any word he gives. You will learn. And your own life. And they pass. And they pass. Thank you. About what I love here so far. One last question. If somebody can ask me, if I can answer, I can't. And giggle at me. Otherwise, we will stay in heaven. Now may the peace of God that surpasses all understanding keep God to rise and rise and rise. Now, all the truth. Okay, now I'm going to ask you to be worshipful and join me as together we confess our mutual faith in the words of God, which I see in the reading. Please, let's rise. Lord, I believe in one God, Father of men, the Creator of heaven and earth. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of His Father, and the Holy Ghost, God of God, light of light, very God, very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven. And was incarnate by the Holy Spirit who was regenerated and was made a man, and who was crucified also for us in the cross of Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended to heaven, and he sits at the right hand of the Father. He will be overcome again with the glory which is manifest over the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I give you the Holy Spirit, the Lord of your life, who proceeds from the Father and Son, who with the Father and Son together is worshipped and glorified, who is glorified by God. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead, and the life of the world to come. My dear friends, let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, for all people according to their needs. Almighty God, with the whole creation, we praise you for your gift of life and the world that sustains us in all religions. Grant that seeing your even greater gift of deliverance from the disfigurement of sin and the promise of the renewal of your original design, all people may come to repentance and faith in your gracious invitation through Jesus Christ, risen and victorious over death. Lord, in your mercy, give power to your word as it is proclaimed boldly by your church filled with the Holy Spirit and the faithful witness of all of us. As it is previously taught by all who are ordained and who are supervised, as well as those to whom you have given the gifts to be faithful witnesses of your salvation and glory, Lord, in your mercy. Turn the hearts of all who hear the authority of our government, our land, and around the world that they serve and lead all people in the way of justice, peace, and freedom, Lord, in your mercy. To all who suffer sickness or injury, give the comfort in your community. To all who suffer any persecution for standing to the truth of the Christian faith, give strength to endure. To all who preach faithfulness, believing that the risen Christ leads us to the glory of eternal life in your kingdom. Even as we lay before you our petitions at this very moment, know that we hold it in our own hearts. And those that we lay before you now, publicly before your church. For those who suffer from that dead disease of cancer like Jeff and Kevin and Carla and Kimberly, we also have Bob Bruce, who is suffering from also from cancer, who is now to the doctors who minister to all these, your children, that they may learn to develop ways to treat them and to the glory of your name, reduce their cancer even further. Those who need other healing, like Ann and Don and Gail and Cheryl and Roberta and many others, to them too. Touch their bodies. Heal and restore them to the glory of your name. And we as a family and friends, who are even now for Danielle Lanning and Gail and Thomas, bless them, Lord. Touch them, let them know that it really is okay. And that their dearly beloved is in your arms for all eternity. These are the things we lay before you and ask you, Lord, in your mercy. In your hands, O Lord, you lay all the wounds and pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I'd like you to be seated. And forwarding our gifts to God, we will sing to Him as His Christians our very worshipful. Thank you. the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them to the Lord.
Christ give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and sound in hearing. That we should, at all times and in all places, give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God. And most especially, our devout praise on this day for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, the very Paschal Lamb, who was sacrificed for us and bore the sins of the world. By his dying, he destroyed them. By his rising again, he has destroyed us with everlasting life. Therefore, with Mary Magdalene, Peter, and John, and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heavenly God, and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing.
Thank you.
I also have to do this.